that she's always carried with her, especially when she's been counted out, which of course was a bit of a theme this week, right? We heard her say she's often been underestimated, but she's never doubted herself. So that, I think, was a really interesting point to see her make, particularly because she is somebody who would much rather talk about her record than her own biography.
I think her bringing so many family members on stage just helped to really sell this narrative and give you the behind-the-scenes look at her as someone who can connect to people who have to work at McDonald's like she says she had to do, and who may be having difficulties with just keeping some of the basic necessities. She let them know that she knows where they're coming from and had people on stage who can back up that story.
We heard that much, didn't we? This reference to, I know about the middle class because I am middle class. I will work for the middle class because I am middle class. And contrasting her background with that of Donald Trump, Courtney.
Yeah, I think at one point she really tried to underscore building up the middle class. She called it the defining goal of her presidency if she was to win in November. We haven't heard a ton from her on, you know, detailing her policy, but she's really underlined that idea of tax breaks for the middle class, building up the middle class, which echoes a lot of what Joe Biden did as well during his presidency, which of course she's part of his administration. It was a point that she really wanted to drive home in terms of contrasting herself to Donald Trump as somebody who is looking out for the wealthy, according to her.
She did talk, in a way, headlines of what her policies might be, perhaps not lots of detail, but what she was hoping to achieve, what she was hoping to get done. What stood out for you there, Brandon?
Yeah, I know talking to people here today earlier, one of the more common things people were looking to hear was how she was going to bring together the country and to help heal divisions. People were saying that they're tired of the toxicity that they see in politics. And I think she touched on that in a lot of her messaging, where she talked about an injustice against one of us is an injustice against all of us. You know, I'm going to create economic opportunities for everyone. So I think her campaign did a good job of keeping their ear to the ground to know that people are looking, you know, to bring everyone together. And she used we and united, and, you know, I accept this nomination on behalf of the people. She really drive home that point of, unlike the chaos that Democrats say Trump brings and the division that they say Trump brings, she's here to do the opposite.
And the Democrats really have rallied together over the last few days. I mean, you'd expect that in many ways. It is their convention. They're trying to put forward that vision of unity, excitement, and energy, which was not the case just over a month ago when there was a completely different candidate. Let's have a look at some of the highlights of the convention and how this was addressed. Courtney, everyone that Democrats would want to see came out this week. Oprah Winfrey, Bill Clinton, Stevie Wonder. Were those the highlights for the crowd?
Certainly for, you know, older members of the party, having figures like Bill Clinton, who's considered the great communicator.
Kamala Harris is the only candidate in this race who has the vision, the experience, the temperament, the will, and yes, the sheer joy to get something done.
Having Oprah Winfrey, who is a cultural touchstone for a lot of people.
When a house is on fire, we don't ask about the homeowner's race or religion. We don't wonder who their partner is or how they voted. No, we just try to do the best we can to save them.
Who's also sort of shied away from the political spotlight in recent years. She did endorse Barack Obama, who she counts as a personal friend, in 2008. She hasn't really been in the limelight, political limelight, and she really cast herself as an independent and was trying to appeal to independent voters in her speech. So I think that was a highlight for some of the older members of the party, while we saw some younger members, you know, really enthusiastic, certainly about the Obamas and maybe some of the celebrities that we saw come out on Kamala Harris's behalf this week.
Let's talk about the Obamas for a moment, particularly Michelle Obama, Brandon. There was a tremendous reaction to her, wasn't there?
Yeah, she definitely had the crowd captivated and received a rock star-like reception.
Kamala knows, like we do, that regardless of where you come from, what you look like, who you love, how you worship, or what's in your bank account, we all deserve the opportunity to build a decent life. All of our contributions deserve to be accepted and valued. Because be an American. No one.
Both Michelle and Barack had the crowd really animated into what they were saying, repeating the chants, laughing at the punchlines. When it ended, I asked people, you know, which do you feel delivered a stronger performance? And everyone pretty much unanimously said Michelle. So, you know, she lived up to her reputation, which Barack even commented on as he walked on stage saying, I made the mistake of signing up to speak after my wife.
We can't forget, of course, about the vice presidential pick, Governor Tim Walz, Courtney. He really gave also a barnstorming speech, didn't he?
He did, and I think he really performed in his role as Kamala Harris's attack dog. He gave a forceful speech. He went after Trump. He highlighted his own background as a coach, as a congressman, as a school teacher. And I think for a lot of Americans, that came off as relatable, you know, as somebody you know from the Midwest.
We're all here tonight for one beautiful, simple reason. We love this country. Boy, do we have the right team. Kamala Harris is top. Kamala Harris is experienced, and Kamala Harris is ready.
And I think in terms of introducing himself on the national stage at a moment when, you know, we've seen him sort of face some stumbles or some previous controversies, it was by all means a success for Tim Walz.
There's a lot of talk all week long about unity within the party, but we can't gloss over the fact that there isn't unity in the party. And outside here and in Chicago, we had many protests and demonstrations, some delegates staging a sit-in outside here for quite some time. How do you think they handled that, Courtney, or Kamala Harris in particular?
Well, we did hear a bit of her speech tonight addressing the situation in Gaza, reinforcing the U.S. policy on defending Israel. She didn't veer at all from the administration talking points on that, but, you know, did say that she supported Palestine's right to dignity and freedom, and she did say that the humanitarian situation needed to be addressed, and she was working with the president on trying to secure a ceasefire. But I don't think that would satisfy some of the protesters outside who were hoping that the Democrats would make room for a Palestinian to speak at the event this week. They had asked for over 2 months for a speaking slot, and last night some Harris advisors and Democrats came out to speak to the protesters and try and emphasize that today was about Harris as the nominee. But there's a lot of disappointment that their protests weren't being heard, so we'll have to see how that plays out, especially in states like Michigan, which is a battleground state.
So, Brandon, do you think, can we call this convention a success? Are there signs of unease within the Democratic camp?
I think by and large it was successful. I've been comparing it to church on Easter Sunday, and, you know, it's like there's no sin and everyone's going to heaven. And at the Democratic convention, it felt like victory in November was inevitable. There was really no division within the party. Everyone here is pretty much drinking the Democratic Kool-Aid, and I think that the speakers they brought out, all the way up to Vice President Harris, said what people wanted to hear and said it in a way that got them excited about the election. You know, the we're not going back is something that people have really bought into, and no matter who said that, the crowd would just go crazy and repeat after her. So the messaging has stuck, people are excited, and it seems as if they're ready to go out and carry on this momentum from here through the race.
So we've looked at the highlights of the Democratic National Convention and the biggest speech of Kamala Harris's career. Next, I want to talk about whether the Democrats' current momentum will actually translate to votes at the ballot box in November and what hurdles could lie ahead.
In a quarter mile, slight left onto Back Maitland Road.
This is the global story from the BBC World Service. There's a fresh episode available as a podcast each weekday. please do like and subscribe so you don't miss out. And before we get back to today's conversation, I just want to let you know about a couple of those episodes that we're working on.
Make a slight left onto Back Maitland Road.
Huge amounts of money spent by candidates in the US presidential campaign. And we'll also have all the analysis after the first...
Continue for 11 miles.
Donald Trump and Kamala Harris in September. So if you have a question you want answering on those or any topic, you can get in touch by email at theglobalstory@bbc.com or send us a message on WhatsApp. Our number is +44 330 123 9480. I'm in Chicago speaking to Courtney Supermanian and Brandon Drennan from the BBC's digital team. But Kamala Harris's opponent, Donald Trump, came up quite a few times this week, as might be expected, in various speeches and also in the speech tonight, of course, from Vice President Kamala Harris herself. Brandon, what did you make of those mentions of Donald Trump?
You know, one of the things Democrats have been concerned about in November is whether or not voters had Trump amnesia, and if they were going to have the same enthusiasm to come out and vote to keep him out of office. And I think she was intentional and did a pretty strong job of reminding them of the things about Trump that they didn't like in 2020 when they came out to vote for Biden.
In many ways, Donald Trump is an unserious man. But the consequences of putting Donald Trump back in the White House are extremely serious.
When she was attacking Trump was when I saw many of the strongest reactions from the crowd. And, you know, abortion is one of her strong points, and she did a very good job, as she's done multiple times up to today, of reminding people of what Trump has said about having the Supreme Court overturn Roe v. Wade and how she's going to fight to get abortion rights federally protected.
Well, we trust women.
Trump was a smart move because the audience really appeared to be buying into it.
And changing the top of the ticket so late in the game, Courtney, has meant that Donald Trump and the Republican Party writ large are having to pivot their messaging and their strategy to varying degrees of success. How has that changed for them?
I think they really struggled in the first few weeks to try and land messaging on Kamala Harris. As you said, their entire campaign was built around Joe Biden and Joe Biden's record. They've tried to pin her to his record as vice president, but that doesn't seem to have landed with voters as much as they would have liked. And they've been unable to define her in a way that's been effective for, you know, voters. Tonight, we heard from Donald Trump throughout her speech. He was responding in real time. We also heard him call into Fox News afterward to offer his criticisms. He said, you know, over the last 3.5 years, she complained about all these things. Why didn't she do anything about that? Why hasn't she implemented any of the policies that she's talking about tonight?
Well, the biggest reaction is, why didn't she do the things that she's complaining about? All of these things that she talked about, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to do everything, but she didn't do any of it. She could have done it 3.5 years ago. She could do it tonight. She could have done all of these things, and she could still do them. She's got 4.5 months left. She can go there right now.
So I think we'll see, as she tries to paint herself as a change candidate, somebody who tonight talked about a new way forward, we'll see Donald Trump and his campaign try and really emphasize that she is the incumbent candidate in so many ways as she continues, you know, the Joe Biden's administration.